acting career has been reduced since Departed. I still like floating that picture out there.
There's only one Uncle Jackie.
Uncle Jackie is the best. We should get a nomination for that, I think. It was a fine performance.
That's what I did.
How are you doing?
I'm good.
Do you have enough on your plate, or you need to do another half dozen movies at a time?
Oh, no. I'm actually slowed down this year. I didn't really do it. I didn't do
only four movies this year.
No. Just partnered with Warner's on Argo and put a bit into World War Z.
Just a little bit of care and a little bit of cash there.
And yeah, you know, if you can't find the right material, then I'm not going to make a movie, you know.
Well, you're on time delay, so because for you this year is next year for us.
Exactly. Looking forward to next year, though. Getting into some good product next year, some good movies next year.
Well, last year was a pretty good year then for this. That's this year. Right. Hugo was last year.
It's all about Hugo. Right.
Well, Hugo's been a while. That took a little while, no?
Yeah, we were actually going to make it after Departed, Marty and I, and one thing led to another, and he went off and did Shutter Island, and I had about four or five filmmakers come to me saying, you know, I would like to do it if Marty's not doing it, and I just couldn't do it with anyone except him, and I knew he had a passion to make this movie.
It's kind of hard to imagine it being made a few years earlier because technologically, besides the 3D, a lot of this stuff actually would be, I think, much more expensive 3 or 4 years ago.
No? Yeah, I mean, even the size of the camera from when we were shooting to now has shrunken a lot to make it a lot easier.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was driving down on Link Pit Boulevard and my car phone went and it was Marty and he said, I've got an idea, let's shoot this in 3D.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, sounds great, after I hit the car in front of me. So, you know, who better to tell that story about really the birth of cinema and paying homage to cinema with the latest technology? I mean, it's kind of all mixed into one. It was kind of weird being on the set because you've got all these characters, you know, in 1930s costume in this huge concourse train station. Mm-hmm. And then you've got behind the scenes, you had loads of technical guys on their laptops and on their, you know, on the computers, and look at all these people around, you know, because of the 3D, and it's such a contrast, you know, to see that.
It is. It's kind of surreal that he is the age he is and still pressing the envelope the way he does.
You got to take your hat off to him. I mean, for a man in his time in his career to really, I don't know, people say come out of his wheelhouse or whatever to try not just a story that he really hadn't done before with these characters, but with the technology that had never been used before. Mm-hmm. I mean, there was a lot going on that set.
Yeah.
But, you know, he's Scorsese. He knows how to handle it.
Well, would make you be immodest if you answered the question correctly, but, I mean, it seems like a lot of guys his age stop making films. It just gets harder for studios to fund them and whatever, and it seems like you've been part of this wave with him.
Right.
Where he's never made bigger films. It's actually like he's had another breadth of career. In part because you've helped fund these much bigger, much more kind of complex projects with him.
Right. Well, it's worked. You know, we funded, started off with Gangs of New York, and financially we got out of that movie. and then, you know, Aviator and Departed was funded by Warner Brothers, you know.
Yeah.
And now this one, and this one is, I'm going to go on the record and say it's the best movie I've ever been involved in. Because I really feel that a lot of the reason I'm in this business is because of the story in this film.
Mm-hmm.
And it has so many layers to it. You know, you've seen it. I mean, so many layers to it. You know, it's hard to give an interview and talk about the film because it takes so long.
Right.
You know, from the automaton to the mechanics of the clocks to a boy trying to find a home. You know, to the wacky world of the station inspector.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've got, obviously, the Jorge Mendes story. And the whole tribute to cinema and paying homage to cinema like that. And it's very, what I found by screening it, it's been very educational, but in an entertaining way. And, and that's such a joy to be able to bring that. I showed it to 60 kids last week in LA, and they were movie-going kids from Calabasas and Thousand Oaks and whatever. And, and they couldn't believe what they were watching. And they felt so emotional afterwards and felt that they had learned so much about cinema.
Well, when Logan talked about doing the film, or writing the film, he brought you up a couple of times. It was like, you know, everybody's Marty, 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 but he actually mentioned that your involvement as well How hands-on are you at this point in everything? Is that a big part of what you do, do you feel?
I think so. I mean, it's relationships. You know, it comes down to having the right relationships and really giving someone a shot and then realizing that, you know, what your boundaries as a producer, producer is. Certainly with Scorsese, it's been four films now, and we pretty much have it down pat, what I do and what he does and everything else.
Right.
And then, you know, there's other movies where you kind of just look over who's running the show, you know, who the heads of the departments are, you know. And Angelina Jolie went off and directed this movie in Budapest, you know, and I just went on and off that set a couple of times because I was with Marty doing Hugo.
Right.
So you kind of have to pick, for me anyway, you know, which are the more important ones.
Mm-hmm. What was the thing that got you into this in the first place?
In the film business?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. I think just my love for film, my love for cinema growing up. It sounds cliche, but, you know, as Taxi Driver and Mean Streets and movies that my mum and dad were divorced when I was young, so my mum would take me to movies, you know, more musical, lighthearted comedies, and my dad would take me to see Zulu, you know, and all the great war movies, you know. I mean, I'm doing my passion project now. I've got Robert Towne writing, not really a remake, but a version of The Battle of Britain, which would be, you know, a fantastic story to tell. And I, you know, growing up with my grandparents, my mum and dad in London, who lived through that whole war, especially the Battle of Britain, you know, the Messerschmitts and Spitfires fighting above the city of London. And so, you know, it's I've been trying to put this together for a while, and to have the great Robert Towne writing it, it's incredible.
So you have a childhood kind of love of film? Just this is part of your...
Absolutely. I was in the cinema every Friday night, every Friday and Saturday near enough.
Yeah. I envy you actually seeing Zulu on a screen. I don't think I've ever seen it on a screen. I think I've seen it on television a million times. But
yeah, it's fantastic. So as
introducing
I said,
Michael Caine.
Exactly.
It's craziness. And so how did you make this conversion? Is there a moment where you said, okay, I want to be in the film business. This is part of my idea of the world.
Right. Well, my mother... really dragged me to California when I was very young. She wanted, first of all, London wasn't a great place to be in the late 70s, the 80s, and she didn't feel that it was right for me to, if I wanted to pursue film, you know, what other place, where else is there to go than LA? And I went straight to LA.
So she knew and she supported that?
Yeah, she supported it and she loved California.
Mm-hmm.
She had a lot of friends that lived over there, and I was 17 when I got off the Pan Am flight, you know, and kind of welcome to LA. And really never looked back and got a job at Fox, 20th Century Fox, just kind of like a kid errand boy, you know, type of thing, just doing whatever I was doing and learning, learning the process all the way. And, you know, sometimes, and you know this, everyone in their career, you know, you have a bit of luck with some determination. You know, someone can open doors for you, you've got to go through them now.
So did you know initially that you wanted to produce, or did you have other ideas?
No, I didn't know really what a producer does. I think a lot of people, that's the most popular question I get asked, what do you actually do? So I wasn't
sure. And the answer
is
whatever you need to do, it sounds like.
The definition of producer, we could be here 3 hours talking about that, right? So,
well, just on these four really films. You could,
right.
Last
exactly.
year, this year.
Right. So it's really... all I knew is I wanted to be in the film business, and I started in distribution at 20th Century Fox, international distribution. So I got to know the marketplace vis-a-vis, and back then, I'm talking about the mid-80s, no one cared about international.
Right.
You know, it wasn't like today where big movies were opening, you know, overseas.
Well, Fox is excited because they're releasing Titanic in April.
Right.
Which has never been released in Russia. It's never been released in China. There are all these countries that never been
that's
released
it.
In.
That's it. Yeah. I mean, we used to go off, and this was in the TV business even, we used to go off to these, like, TV markets in Monte Carlo and Cannes and whatever, and we used to just, boy, we used to sell, like, gangbusters packages of movies and TV shows. And the studio didn't really care. We were like at the back of the lot in the corner somewhere, and we were like the lowlifes, you know, being an international. And then obviously with the help of Murdoch and guys like that, TV just exploded internationally, and the international market exploded theatrically as well. And I got right into that and caught right into that. But that's where I used to make my living from, was international sales, and still do, really. Yeah. We still do a lot of that. Like the Rum Diary, you know, we pre-sold that all over the world to cover an investment. So, you know, there's some movies I'll see and we'll pre-sell, and there's others we'll go through the studio system with.
And did you, I mean, do you see yourself, like this year in particular, I guess there's two Johnnies, a Marty and an Angelina. Right. Or last year, this year, whatever.
Right.
But, I mean, there's definitely that Marty thing, there's definitely that Johnny thing. Did you, is that, you only have so many hours in the day and you have people who you really want to work with pretty much in everything they do, or?
No, not really. It's about the opportunity and it's about material. You know, the Johnny relationship has just been, it's just grown over the years, you know, and I first met Johnny and, you know, he said he wanted to be in business with me and I wasn't sure why we'd never really met. And, you know, we spent some time getting to know each other and then I asked him, why me? And he said, because you make films with Scorsese. And that's where Marty has made my career for me without him even knowing, let alone winning an Oscar for one of his directed movies. You know, he's just such an icon, such a legend. And, you know, there's not a director that I can't sit in a room with because, you know, I've made three or four films with Martin Scorsese relationships. Mm-hmm. Actors adore Scorsese, as you know. They all want to be in his films. So, again, you know, if we're making Scorsese films, it's not hard to get any actor on the phone. As you know, Leonardo loves working with him, and that relationship was coming off of Gangs of New York and seeing where we can move forward. We are in a business, and for me as an independent, you know, I'm not Warner Brothers or Sony sitting down. As an independent, I've got to look at ways to keep my business going. And if it's talent relationships or writer relationships, director relationships, that's the only way I know how to do it in this game.
Well, I think the Marty thing is probably not just working with him, but the fact that he can work with you and he's happy.
Right.
And he's thriving while working with you,
right.
You know, as opposed to, you know, situations where a producer may be able to, you know, do this or that, but can't, it's not a good relationship.
Right. Well, that's with all of them. If it didn't work, then I wouldn't be in business with them, or they wouldn't be in business with me.
Yeah.
Repeat business. You know, it does work with Marty, and, you know, I've gotten very accustomed to the way he works and the way he thinks out the box and the way he always collaborates with actors and come up with new ideas. You know, and as a producer, you've got to be on your toes 24/7 when he's shooting a film.
Right.
Because at any given time, they'll say, hey, we've got an idea for something. And whether you really like it or not, that's going to happen. And he's going to try it.
Right.
Which makes for a much better film, you know. And there's been times where you just go, wow. I mean, I remember on Departed, you know, him and Jack Nicholson talking about wearing a dildo. What? You know, as a producer, you go, what was that? And I was like, yeah, we're going to try this, you know, this scene out. And Jack's going to have this strap on dildo. And it's things like that. You just, you know, again, if you don't want to go through that, then don't work with someone like Scorsese with this kind of talent, you know. And the same with Hugo. It happened in Hugo, you know, with Sasha, you know, being dragged along the train. And these are all ideas that came off during the shoot. You know, and then he'll come up with other things. I remember about 2 weeks before we started shooting Hugo, he called me and he said, I need to sit down with you. And I said, okay. And I went into his office. He goes, sit down and relax. I'm like, uh-oh, what's coming? And he opened the Hugo Cabré book up to the scene with the train going through the window, smashing through the window and half on the floor. And he said, I think we should shoot this. Because I'd already always gone over that. Oh, no, we'll leave that. You know, dollar signs and stuff. And we sat and talked through why. And, you know, it's a fantastic scene in the movie now. You know, it's the dream sequence.
So how do you, I mean, do you have two different hats for the art versus the commerce? I mean, is there a time where you go, okay, I know what it costs, but now we have this movie and now we'll...
Right.
We're our hands in the fate of the movie lovers everywhere?
Definitely. I mean, it's really tough. And whether it's I'm financing or the studio's financing, it's all the same to me. It's a very toughest job for a producer is finding that balance about finance. And a lot of producers finance movies with studios and they don't think about it. Because I do some from the studio and some myself, I always think about it and I'm always wary of it. But it's in some cases, it doesn't really matter. The creative has to take over. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't.
So this is smaller. I mean, obviously the Angelina film is much smaller than other stuff you're working on.
Right.
But does the scale of it serve a purpose, or is it just these are the projects that you work with? And because most of the stuff you do is pretty big.
Right. Well, the size to me is irrelevant. It's how much is it worth? Huh. Right? So if I'm making a $10 million movie, is it worth $10 million? Can I get that back? You know, if it's $100 million, is it worth $100 million?
Right.
So it's really down to project by project, you know, that we go through it. And again, we do have the luxury of sometimes pre-selling movies, sometimes not, you know.
Right.
Everyone, last Christmas, everyone was reporting that I was getting my butt kicked on the tourist financially. And I didn't. I got out. Thanks to international.
Thanks to international.
But, you know, the movie did, I think, 285 or something. And because it did 65 domestic and the rest in the international, it was a flop. If it would have done 100 domestic and 185 overseas, it wouldn't have been a flop.
Right.
You know, but I have to look at, obviously, the whole price. So
when if it did 100 here and 65 overseas, you would have been in trouble.
Right.
And nobody even thinks about that. You know, it would have been a hit because it did $100 million.
Absolutely.
Here. Yeah. Well, it's hard. I think journalists have become, in terms of box office, it's a little funny space because we don't get consistent reporting out of the rest of the world, and they're on a different schedule, and everybody wants the answer today.
Right.
And it's like, by the time you actually get the international results, which are now more than domestic, almost inevitably, you know, the story's already passed. We can't do 1, 2, 3 the way we're used to.
Absolutely.
So, and I assume that's, you know, that's been pretty much your bread and butter from the beginning. Is
the international. Absolutely. I look heavily. I still, again, because that was my background. When I read a script now, I'm wondering how much this would do in Japan, Germany, Spain, Italy, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, that's big values to movies.
Mm-hmm.
And so one has to look at that. It can't just be the North American market.
So when a movie like The Tourist gets, you hired a director who was revered, or is revered, coming off The Lies of Others, and you've got the two of the biggest movie stars in the world, and you got slaughtered by the critics.
Right.
Matter much to you as you're sitting there knowing how much it's going to make?
Yeah, absolutely it does. Unfortunately, I cruise the net just like everyone else does, and I read all the comments. My publicist sitting over there, crazy, but I do, and it's such an addiction, right? I mean, you can't help it, you know, and it mattered a lot. It mattered a lot to me last year, but as someone very close to me said, you know, you're making up more movies, and you know, maybe more movies you maybe be more proud of, and it happens sometimes, you know.
So would you rather have a movie where you take a $10 million loss than a movie that gets killed and you make 50?
I don't. It's funny, you can't really think of it that way, you know. I think certainly on most movies, I want to be proud of them, and I want them to do both, you know. And I've been lucky enough to where, okay, they haven't been big blockbuster hits, but they've broken even, or we've found a way to get out, no matter what I've done. Otherwise, I wouldn't be in business anymore. I don't think there's anyone quite like my company in Hollywood that takes the risks that we take and looks at the creative ways to, you know, get out of a movie or let it go. I mean, certainly this movie, I've never been more proud of anything I've ever done in Hugo.
Mm. What's interesting is, like, Rudin gets credit for... there's a different perspective on Rudin, I guess, than there is on you. And part of it's being New York, and part of it's the theater, and part of it's being Rudin. But it's an interesting thing, because you do take as many chances. You do make, you do fund movies that are hard to, would normally be hard to fund, or you find ways to get them funded.
Right.
It's a weird box how everybody kind of gets put in their place.
Right.
But you're a little bit of a mystery man, I think, to a lot of people also.
Well, I think the big difference between Scott and myself is I write the checks. And he finds studios to write the checks, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I'm lucky enough to have a business partner that just loves film and is passionate for films. So, you know, we've had this fantastic relationship where, you know, he loves the movies I want to make, and he, you know, backs me financially.
Mm-hmm.
And he's just terrific. And again, you know, we've done okay financially. Otherwise, he wouldn't be still with me. But there's a big difference between having Sony or Warner's or someone write the check than when it's yourself. There's no question about it. I mean, it adds a huge layer.
Have you been affected dramatically by the whole DVD shift in the West?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I've been affected by a lot of things. But that, you know, you have to be more careful in the business, and you have to find ways to get more creative, you know. But we're still in a risk business, you know. Right. When Ben Affleck came to Jeff Rabinoff and myself and he said, I want to write, direct, and star in The Town, you know, we thought long and hard about that. And it comes down to, okay, well, let's make sure the budget, you know, is in a comparable place for him to take the chance to do that and for us mm-hmm. to take the risk. And it, you know, it's great when it pays off. Sometimes it doesn't, but that's mm-hmm. the business we're in, right?
Are those the best surprises when something like The Town becomes this kind of phenomenon?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, it's just when you give someone a chance and they come through in life, mm-hmm. you know, then you're the hero, right? If not, then you get the blame. And it's like Angelina as well, you know, mm-hmm. she's, the world is going to see, or hopefully see, you know, what a job she's done at directing a film for the first mm-hmm. time. And when you take those risks and they pay off creatively, you mm-hmm. know, and financially, is fantastic. But it's always a balance.
So you're in, what part of Hugo is your favorite part of Hugo?
I think it's the scene when Renée Tabard comes to the apartment mm. and discovers that Melez is really alive, and Helen McCrory that plays Melez's wife is just so fantastic in that scene. It's so emotional. It still yeah. gets me after I've seen it so many times. You mm. know?
Well, the fact that she can't resist seeing it is kind of beautiful, and
it's also a very Hollywood act, right? An actress, yeah. you know, they can't yeah. resist, but to look at their careers and, you know, come back. But it's just beautiful. It is beautiful, and it's sensitive, and I think an audience really appreciates that. And as I say, it's all in the way it's portrayed and presented, and it's a big turn in Hugo's search to find a home.
Mm. So how was it for you along the route to that happening? Obviously, the shooting is the shooting, and it's, you know, going through somebody else's camera. But then there's footage. I assume you're overlooking as things are being cut.
Right.
And then it starts to come together. Where are you in the happiness scale or the scale along
well,
that route?
Well, it's you know, usually the case with Marley is when you get to see the first cut, you know, you just kind of go, oh, my God, you know, what has he done? You know, it's you kind of, as a producer, it's hard not to get carried away fully with his work, because you mm-hmm. have to do producerial duties still, and you have to work, and you have to get mm-hmm. the movie finished. But you just look at his work, and when you see it finally on screen, especially this one, how beautiful it looked, and the 3D, and the mm-hmm. emotion, and a happy ending, and the performances, there's just so much going into it. I saw the movie in his office for the first time on a Thursday night, and then we had dinner, and I said, I've mm-hmm. got to see it again tomorrow. There's just too much to take in. Mm-hmm. You know, and I was so, the first screening, I was so affected by the 3D. So I'd never seen 3D like that before either. I mean, it was just...
So you're not really watching cuts as stuff is coming out of the Avid?
Well, I'm watching dailies, and, you know, he'll show me bits when I was in New York. I always come to New York, and he right. would show me, you know, scenes and stuff, but you don't...
But you're not seeing his first assemblage and stuff like that?
No, well, that no, suffrage. No. He'll never show that.
Well, they always say that's the ugliest moment for any filmmakers, and they see their first assembly. That there's the horror show that it actually, you know, because it's not been formed yet.
Right, really. Right. Well, I mean, possibly. I mean, you know, when it's Marty and Thelma, they got pretty much a lot. They've been, you know, yeah. together for so many years. And it's a process with him that I've been lucky enough to go through for 4 movies now. So I know exactly the process, and I know when to get involved and when not to get involved, and let him mm-hmm. do his thing. And again, it's like that all the way down the road with Marty from start to finish. Mm. You know, and it's sometimes it's easy for a producer, sometimes it's harder.
So are you confident when you sat in the room pretty much by yourself watching it in 3D that you knew what you had, or did you need to get it up in front of an audience before you were completely sure where you were? Or?
I knew we had, I'll be bold here, I knew we had a masterpiece. Mm. I really feel that this movie is going to be around for a long, long time and going to be spoken about as part of Scorsese's body of work for a long time. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to obviously look on the other side and look at, well, let's put it in front of an audience, let's get the test results and blah, right. blah, blah. But first and foremost, mm-hmm. I knew we had a film that we set out to make.
Right.
You know, a very emotional story. Of course, it's got, as I say, it pays huge homage to the history of film. But it's also, you know, at the bottom... The bottom layer is a kid trying to find a family. And mm-hmm. hopefully people will realize that and go and see it. And
will you take satisfaction? I mean, do you have a producerial idea of what the satisfaction will be? Do you have a number in your head that you're going, I'll feel better after we've hit this number? I mean, obviously there's a business side where, yes, you have to hit a number. But there's also just a sense of, I guess, doing well by Marty. Because you love the movie and you want it to be seen.
Right. I want it to be seen, first and foremost. I want people to discover it. You know, we all know, and the press are talking about it all the time online, that it's not the easiest of sells. You know, I feel like we've got a great campaign out there. And I just feel that people are going to really need to discover the film. Mm-hmm. And if they do, we're going to be great. You know, we're going to be fine. You know, and I also think there's going to be strong word of mouth. You just don't see films like this anymore.
No.
And I know an audience, you know, sometimes you put them in a box. Oh, they want comic book movies or R-rated comedies or blah, 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 blah. But I still believe there's a world out there where people want to be taught and see a really fun story and be entertained for a couple of hours. And that's what this movie is. It's so entertaining, let alone the 3D of it all. There's mm-hmm. so much, as you know, when we made this film, 3D was the thing in Hollywood. Everyone was making, you know, and of course that turned during our post schedules, you know. But again, this is 3D like no one has seen before. And to have a few weeks ago, you know, Jim Cameron and Marty do that Q&A, and for Jim to say this is the best 3D movie I've ever seen, you know, he wasn't saying that to plug our movie or to help us out. He meant it.
Yeah.
And I'm really hoping people latch onto that and go and check out this 3D movie as opposed to others.
Well, at some point, we won't be in 3D. We'll be seeing it on, you know, Blu-ray and things like that. Some people have 3D TVs, but most will not. Right. And, you know, it's. I think the experience will also be great there. I think this is, you know, as you say, this is something I think will linger more than other things.
Right. Well, that's what I'm hoping at the box office. I'm not looking to compete with Twilight and Muppets and Happy Feet 2, you know? But that's the world we live in, right?
Yeah.
But I'm looking for longevity and for the movie to grow and be discovered. And hopefully, if it does, you know, we'll get to a number that gets us out the film.